Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sacker. The global coronavirus pandemic has prompted governments across the world to take emergency measures, restricting liberties to safeguard public health. And no European nation has gone further than Hungary. Well, my guest today is Hungary's chief international spokesman, Zoltán Kovács. Has COVID-19 ushered in Europe's first de facto dictatorship? Zoltán Kovács in Budapest, welcome to Hard Talk.
Good to talk to you.
Would you explain for me the reasoning behind the extraordinary powers that your government has taken in the wake of the coronavirus crisis?
I believe the reasons are as simple as in any country around, not only Europe, but around the globe. We face an unknown enemy, if it's about the virus. We've seen viruses coming and going, but this one seems to be special and seems to be so much unknown that most governments in Europe and around the globe have asked for some kind of extraordinary measure actually to be able to handle the situation and address the challenges according to what happens day by day or week by week. Nobody knows when the pandemic is going to end. That's why we have asked for, from Parliament, obviously, the extraordinary measures which entitle the government that only for fighting the virus, we can be swift, decisive, and effective, efficient as soon as it is required.
You rightly point out many governments in Europe have taken emergency measures. Yours are different in several key instances. Let us begin with perhaps the most important of all. Yours are not time limited. They are absolutely indefinite. And that has caused a huge amount of consternation around Europe and particularly in Brussels. Why indefinite?
Very fortunately, it is definite. Indefinite wouldn't be good. By legal terms, the very fact that we have received the ability to use extraordinary measures from Parliament itself is a limitation. And the very natural limitation of the timing and the termination of the time is the end of the pandemic.
So, yeah, but forgive me, let me stop you right there. Who determines the end of the pandemic emergency?
As it has been declared by the WHO, the World Health Organization, we believe the European and international organizations are going to tell you when the pandemic is over.
But is that written into the emergency legislation?
No, what's written is in the emergency legislation is that Parliament can revoke the extraordinary measures anytime.
But it's quite clear that ultimately the government, led by Mr. Orbán, has been vested with the power for the duration of an emergency, which is not defined in the legislation, has been vested with powers which outstrip powers, executive powers, seen anywhere else in the democratic world. Even some of your own critics at home are calling this dictatorship.
But that's simply not true. Even within Europe, I would be able to tell you four other countries who have an open-end termination, actually, of their powers received from Parliament and by their own constitution and legal framework. I believe Hungary has chosen, the government has received rights and possibilities within the confines of its own constitution and rule of law, according to the circumstances and framework in which the country works. And I believe that's what other countries follow.
It's interesting.
This is what happened with the UK.
Yes.
The UK is trying to follow that.
Mr. Kovács, let's just unpick this a little bit. You keep claiming that you're doing nothing out of the ordinary, that it fits with the mainstream of European governmental response. Plainly, many highly respected voices in senior positions in politics in Europe do not agree. Let me start with the Secretary General of the Council of Europe, which is there to safeguard constitutional rights, democratic values, human rights across Europe. Maria Burić wrote this to Viktor Orbán directly in a letter. quote, an indefinite, uncontrolled state of emergency cannot guarantee that the basic principles of democracy will be observed, nor that the emergency measures restricted these fundamental human rights are in fact proportionate to the threat that they are supposed to counter.
Yes, and you would be able to find almost endless quotations and instances of critical attitudes towards Hungary and the Prime Minister for a reason. It's been happening for the past 10 years. Political lynching, for some curious reason, is the immediate reaction when Hungary chooses its own way handling challenges and problems, not...
Come on, Mr. Kovács, you can't accuse the head of the Council of Europe of political lynching.
Yes, but the thing is that it comes to lynching if you take a look at how it happens. It happens through the Western European press, it happens through the left liberal parties of the European Parliament, and those who didn't really like us for the past 10 years. But let me tell you that as of yesterday, Vera Jourova, who is basically the one or of the two who are responsible overviewing rule of law, constitution, transparency, and all the democratic values within the European Union, explicitly stated that nothing happened in Hungary that goes against the treaty or goes against European values.
Well, with respect, you're quoting one commissioner. I can quote to you many other senior officials in the European Commission, including its chief, Ursula von der Leyen, who are saying they're extremely concerned about what they see happening in your country and will have the EU at institutional level investigate very carefully whether you have flouted the values of the European Union.
And we are ready for that. We are open for it, as well as we require that that monitoring should be on for all European countries. As I just mentioned to you, four other countries have decided to provide for the government open-end rights.
But the point, Mr. Kovács, is that you may say we're doing nothing different, that the overwhelming feeling in the rest of Europe is that you are doing something different. I don't know if you're aware that...
If I may interrupt you for a second. You know, it's been something like maybe 24 times I've heard this, that though there's nothing particular in your legal system, your measures are in line with European treaties, we are concerned. We don't care about political opinion anymore. All countries in Europe have chosen the best and most efficient ways to handle the crisis. That's what Hungary is trying to do. And if you take a look at our numbers, we so far have managed to avoid those problems the UK, Italy, Spain and other countries were not able to avoid because they were not up and they were not ready to make decisive action when it was necessary.
Maybe the most important thing you just said to me there was we don't care anymore. Let's look at some of the specific decrees that the government is now has already passed or is contemplating passing as a result of the new emergency powers, which in effect, let's be honest, put democracy in your country in the deep freeze until the government, the executive, chooses to change the situation. Let's start by looking, for example, at the fact that all political parties under the emergency law are now required to donate 50% of their current account cash to the Hungarian Emergency Response Fund. The opposition parties in your country are saying that this will fundamentally cripple their ability to remain viable voices of dissent and opposition. How does that fit with your Hungarian democracy?
As a matter of fact, opposition parties has asked for monetary financial contribution on behalf of politicians and political parties. This is an opportunity for them actually to participate. But I've got to tell you that you pointed out one issue in a question or putting the question in a way which I'm afraid is really, really available to use the kind of political lynching I've already mentioned. The very hints, the very suggestion which is embedded, which is included in your question, suggests that something abnormal is going on in Hungary. But that's simply not true. We all know that the costs of defense, the costs of measures ahead of us are going to be enormous. We've seen all the countries in Europe, all the countries around the globe coming up with financial monetary measures, new programs. As a matter of fact, Hungary has built up probably the biggest monetary fiscal plan in its history, actually, to go against the effects of the pandemic. And it's simply the case is that Everybody has to participate. Everybody is going to take a share.
So your proposition then is that at a time of economic crisis, it's absolutely fair and proper for the executive, for the government, to raid the coffers of opposition parties. Okay. Well, in economic terms, people will judge that on its merits. But I'm really struggling to see how some of the other actions taken by the government by decree could possibly be connected in any way to the coronavirus crisis. And if one looks at the detail, again, of the way in which your system is being run in this emergency, it is quite plain that you are now using powers to hide... hang on, listen to
please,
my question. You're hiding controversial actions behind this fig leaf. But the truth is, if one looks at a major economic issue facing your country today, that is Chinese investment in a massive railway project, the Belgrade to Budapest railway. You've now ensured during this emergency that there will be no public scrutiny of the economic deals being done on that project.
You have to hang on again. What you are suggesting here is, again, is simply not true. Don't listen to those voices coming from Hungary who are trying to tell you that we have overextended. The law accepted by a two-thirds majority in parliament is explicit. We can make decrees, we can use the extraordinary measures only within the confines of fighting the virus. The topics you have just mentioned, the topics you are trying to accuse us we are overextending, are running through parliament under the normal procedure. It has nothing to do with the extraordinary measures. These are not decrees. These are bills that have been submitted to Parliament, and Parliament is going to decide.
Don't try to
open a debate on something which is simply...
Mr. Kovacs, you're engaged in Alice in Wonderland politics. You've effectively created a government that can do what it's likes by decree. You keep the Parliament sitting there as a fig leaf, and you say, oh no, we're still a parliamentary democracy. All of these issues have to go through the Parliament. You know that in Hungary today, your citizens simply don't buy that.
Again, the very sentences you are pronouncing here, the alleged questions actually, are telling us that you have a preconception about what we do in Hungary without knowing the facts on the ground. All governments around Europe use extraordinary measures in fighting the virus according to the framework, the circumstances which are best for their countries. We are not overextending anything like that. Take a look at Sweden, take a look at France, take a look at all the other countries. It was needed that to be swift, accurate, and decisive, you need extraordinary powers, because what is happening with Europe is extraordinary. Don't try to suggest that the normal elements of life, just because this is happening in Hungary or in any other country in Europe, can override democracy. We are members of the European Union. We believe that if there is a debate with any of the agencies, any of the bodies of the European Union, we shall have that actually through the Commission. And for myself and for the government, the announcement I have just told you from Vera Jourova is reassuring. We are ready for being tested, because all other countries are ready for being tested.
Good, because I look forward to just discussing further with you the detail of your current relationship with the other member states of the European Union in a moment. But just one more question on this complex area of how your government is using the pandemic emergency to enact legislation and take measures which do not, to many people, seem to be connected to the pandemic at all. Let's just go back one more time to a specific, and that is migration. Last month, Hungary indefinitely suspended access to its border transit areas for asylum seekers. Your migration minister claimed, quote, "We observe a clear link between coronavirus and illegal migrants." Can you explain that to me?
Yes, basically all borders in Europe are closed for free movement as we speak. There's only limited movement, especially available for goods, which is essential in the European Union as a unified economic area. But otherwise, even your freedom to travel and my freedom to travel freely to, say, Slovakia or Austria is limited because of the pandemic.
Sure, but you're now not processing any asylum claims at all.
No, we are not. We suspended it for the duration of the pandemic.
That's my point. Now, the Helsinki Committee, again, a human rights organization respected around the world, described your action taken as a result, you claimed, of the pandemic, of another expansion of the Hungarian government's xenophobic hysteria.
Well, apart from the lyrics, actually, that is being sought here by the Helsinki Committee, which we all know of, which is overstatement and very obviously anti-Orban, anti-government. Let me tell you one thing. For us, there is only one thing that comes first, and that is the interest, the security, the health of the Hungarian people. It would be irresponsible to keep your borders open for asylum seekers among circumstances when you cannot guarantee where they come from, what their health status is. It's normal that is happening basically in all European countries, not only towards asylum seekers, but even towards European citizens.
And just one more thought, again, on the expanded nature of Hungary's emergency response to coronavirus. I don't think anybody in Europe would fail to understand why Hungary has closed down its theatres, but one might question why Hungary and the government has taken on the power to change the nature of boards of management at theatres as a result of the coronavirus crisis. Is it because theatres are one of the few remaining cultural places where dissent and criticism of the Orbán government is possible?
Again, your question is carrying a concept that is very deeply political. It has nothing to do with the measures against or towards the pandemic. We've been reorganizing the cultural
I suspect it's got much more to do with your effort to crack down on all forms of cultural dissent.
Yeah, but again, hang on, I mean, you must be kidding. You cannot honestly believe that there's an interpretation. I believe that's an ill concept, actually, to try to put everything on the thread of an anti-government stance in Hungary. You have to be more careful in BBC, accepting the lines that are being echoed by our political opponents here, domestically in Hungary or abroad.
It's interesting you talk about having to be careful. Doesn't Hungary need to be careful? Even before the pandemic and the assumption of these extraordinary emergency powers from your government, the EU Parliament at the beginning of this year had said, quote, the situation in Hungary has deteriorated since the triggering of the Article 7 investigation as to whether your country was in violation of basic EU values. The Parliament's feeling in January, long before this began, was that the situation, your government's actions, are deteriorating.
Very fortunately, the feelings of the European Parliament's liberal leftist politicians is not a thing actually that have an imprint on how we decide here in Hungary. Again, we follow the interests of our Hungarians,
and we follow the democratic patterns. You can throw out these smoke screens as much as you like. It was a clear parliamentary majority that decided that Hungary needed to be investigated under Article 7. It wasn't just the leftists.
The European Parliament simply had no mandate on that. Take a look at how they have broken their own rules accepting that declaration or that decision. And again, if we are engaged in a discussion with a European body, we believe it's a commission who should be addressed and we should be talking to. The commission is the guardian of the treaty. We are open, ready, and have always been ready and open to continue a discussion with them, a normal and proper discussion, not things and not questions as it is coming actually from your mouth, which is having a preconcept of what is happening in Hungary according to our political opponents.
Well, as you know, it's not really my mouth that counts. It's the mouths of the European member states, of the respective human rights organizations.
Yeah, but don't make a generalization
who feed their
it's
information
not the European
into
member
Brussels.
States, it's the Western Europe, especially the Western European liberal, green and socialist parties. We have seen that happening for the past 10 years, that political game, as I told you, that political lynching is going against Mr. Orban and the Orban government for the past 10 years because they don't like that we have an immensely big political support behind us that is giving us a decisive majority in Hungarian Parliament.
The thing is, Mr. Kovács, you are running a risk, aren't you? You've said to me that there are grave economic consequences to the pandemic. I think your government has, got a special emergency economic package which totals tens of billions of euros to try and prop up the Hungarian economy. But in the longer run, if you are to fall foul of an Article 7 decision to, for example, cut structural funding in the future from Brussels to Hungary, on top of this economic crisis that you are bound to face along with everybody else in Europe, you have a very profound problem.
Now, very fortunately, that cannot happen. The treaty is explicit about the distribution of money in Europe. If you wanted to change the algorithm, if you wanted to change the rules, you have to change the treaty. And don't forget that any future budget for the European Union can only be accepted unanimously. We've seen, and that's part actually of the political blackmailing campaign against the country for the past 6-8 years by now, increasingly, that many in Western Europe, I mean leftist, liberal, green politicians, would like to make new conditionalities which are not embedded, which are not included in the treaty. So if they talk about the rule of law, how honestly it is possible actually to go for new measures that would violate the treaty and would violate the rule that makes the acceptance of any kind of budget, again, as I suggested, unanimous. It cannot be done only with us. And again, based on the rule of law, we stick to the original standards and rules in the European Union.
We're almost out of time. I just want to look at the big picture before we finish. I've been very interested in this interview. You've used words repeatedly when we've discussed what's coming from the European Union, from Brussels, from the Council of Europe. You've used words like lynching, like blackmail. It is quite clear your view of what you see coming from the EU institutions. It's also quite clear that during this crisis you've expanded ties with China. They've sent you very significant amounts of emergency material assistance. We've talked about the Chinese investment in the rail line from Budapest to Belgrade, part of the big Belt and Road initiative the Chinese are launching. We've also got your governments showing real support for Vladimir Putin, even offering some sort of travel documents to citizens in East Ukraine who are currently living under de facto Russian control. Is this part of a profound shift in Hungary that you want to embrace the authoritarians and, in essence, you're going to say, we don't care about Brussels. We're going to stay in the Union because it's economically advantageous, but we're not going to listen to all this rubbish that they talk about values.
I thank you for using these words because it would be rude from my mouth, actually, to put it that way. But the summary you have suggested here in your very long question, actually, is just a summary of the accusations we've seen for the past 10 years. If you take a look at the exact numbers and facts behind what you are suggesting here, our ties with either Russia or China have nothing to do with exemplary. It's pragmatic, its volume and nature doesn't even approach the nature and volume you would see in German, Russian, German, Chinese, or Franco-Russian and Franco-Chinese relationship. So don't use double standards here. Hungary is trying to establish good relationship with everyone around us here in Central Europe, in the European Union, and around the globe. And if pointed out China, let me just tell you, who else has sent materials to Hungary that is required to fight the virus? We haven't received anything from Brussels, we haven't received anything from London, and we haven't received anything from Western Europe. Everybody's trying to go for it, and most of the materials can come only from China today. So that's why we have chosen China, like many and basically everybody else.
And just to finish, we've talked a lot about the relationship with Brussels. I think you would agree it's not good right now. Do you think there is any prospect of it getting better as long as your emergency measures are in place?
Well, that would be a logical suggestion from the perspective you suggested throughout the interview, and that is that we are the black sheep of Europe. But this is simply not true. If you take a look at our cooperation with the European institutions, you would find that in 95-98% of the cases, actually, which is about the normal function of the European Union, we are absolutely coming and going together with the majority by common sense and with all the measures, actually, that are good for the country. Indeed, we do have debates at some times, a pretty big debate, actually, about some conceptual elements. And I think we are entitled to have our own concept, our own approach to conceptual ideological issues, and we simply don't accept that there is a dictatorship of opinion or a moral high ground many are trying to occupy in Western Europe. We've seen that happening for 10 years. None of it came true, and it simply cannot be sustained in any debate with Hungary. Take a proper look to the facts, take a proper look to the Hungarian circumstances and framework in which we are trying to make the best and most efficient measures against the virus possible.
Zoltán Kovács, I thank you very much indeed for being on Hard Talk.
You're welcome. Thank you.